Some do. I don't know that all of them do. But he didn't want to introduce me, so I'll introduce myself. Well, see, we were with him down in Louisiana here back in the fall, I guess it was, and we got to know him and Sherry, and, you know, he knows me, Sherry knows me, but, Neil had called me, it's been several weeks ago, I guess, and asked if I would speak this Sabbath. And I didn't know he was going to be here, because he could have done this instead of me. Okay. We were in Texas this week, too, this past week. We were down there Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Got back Wednesday night. But it was interesting. I saw your 3 days of fasting and prayer, and the purpose or the theme is to know Jesus better, to fall deeper in love with Him. I hope what I'm going to talk about today will help you to know Christ a little better. And I hope that it will help us to fall in love with Him as well. Now, Pastor Di didn't tell me what to speak on. I didn't know. But this was the theme that I chose for today. You know, a couple of weeks ago, the whole world was celebrating Easter, or the majority of the world. And I'd been reading about the crucifixion, and you find it in all four Gospels, the crucifixion of Christ. And you find it in Matthew 27, Mark 14, 15, Luke 22 and 23, and John 18 and 19. I chose as the scripture 19 verses 1 through 5, and that's what we're going to be looking at this morning, along with a number of other texts that I have chosen. Let's bow our heads one more time for prayer. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, we again come to You, praising You and thanking You for all Your blessings. And Father, as we come and open Your Word today, we invite Your Holy Spirit to come into our midst. I ask that the congregation see You, not me. That the congregation may hear You and not my voice, that they hear. Father, impart Your Holy Spirit to me. Open my mind and my lips. Open the hearers' ears to hear. For I ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Let's look again at our scripture reading this morning. Again, it's taken from chapter 19 of John. And it says in verse 1 that Pilate therefore took Christ, Jesus, and he scourged Him. Do you know what scourge means? It's an instrument, a short whip-like, and it's got several different braided things on it, thongs, variable links, and they may attach small balls of steel to it. They may have attached sheep's bones to the ends of it, and this is what they use for scourging, and this is what our Christ went through at this time. It says, the man was stripped of his clothing. He was tied to a post. his hands. And then there was either one or two of the soldiers that would begin to whip the individual. And in this case, it was a Christ. The severity of the scourging depended upon how the soldiers were feeling at that time. It says that as the Roman soldiers repeatedly struck the victim's back with the full force of that whipping, the lacerations would begin to appear from the sheep's bones, tearing at the individual's back or his legs. They would tear into the underlying skeletal muscles. Pain and blood loss generally sets a stage for circulatory shock. The extent of the blood loss well determined how long the victim would survive once he was hung on the cross. And then after the scourging, many times the soldiers would taunt their victim. In verse 2, it says, "And the soldiers placed a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe." It says, "And said, Hail, King of the Jews. And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, Behold, I bring him forth to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him." And then verse 5, "Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns, the purple robe, and Pilate saith unto him, Behold the man." Behold the man. Pilate had invited the people there to behold the man, to see this man that he had just scourged, to bring him forward to him. Pilate, in his own way, was trying to save Christ at this point. He knew he was an innocent man and did not deserve death. Whatever his intention was, the vision of Christ standing there before the people did not fail. Did not let them see it, did not have pity on him. They still clamored for his death. And if you can just picture Christ standing there after that crown of thorns had been placed upon his head, the blood that was streaming down his face, the blood that was streaming down his back and his legs, from the scourging that he had just been through. He was mocked. He was ridiculed. But he still retained his dignity. What a man to behold. This man that Pilate had just had scourged, that had his Roman soldiers just treat him with the most cruel and mocking ways that can be done. His body appeared almost the same color as the robe that he had upon his back, and through the lashes he had received on his body. You know, in Isaiah 53, it's a chapter that Ellen White says that we should put to remembrance. It's contemplation that we should have this chapter daily, that we should be contemplating this chapter. It says, talking about Christ, it says, "As a man of sorrow, he's acquainted with grief. He was wounded for our transgressions, and with his stripes we are healed." So who is this man that Pilate said to behold? John 3:16 tells us, and we all know the verse, that he's God's only begotten Son. You know, in Matthew it also said that at Christ's baptism, God said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Again, at the Mount of Transfiguration, as Christ was preparing to go to heaven, God still said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Turn with me to Matthew 1, verse 23. It tells us here that Christ is Emmanuel, meaning God with us. It was the prophecy of Christ's birth in Matthew 1:23, and it says, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel," which being interpreted is God with us. Also turn to 1 Timothy 3, verse 16. It tells us that God is manifested in the flesh here in 1 Timothy 3, 16. It says, "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. He was justified in the spirit. He was seen of angels. He was preached unto the Gentiles. He's believed on in the world. And he was received up into glory." Now, these verses, these words of this verse tell us of the Christian truth. And it says in the first part that it should be without controversy among the believers. But you know, today I think we find many of those who claim to be Christians debate or deny some of these very fundamental truths about Christ. It tells us here in 1 Timothy that God the Son, second person of the Holy Trinity, added to his deity, humanity, and was thus manifested in the flesh. Jesus was justified by the Spirit. He was declared to be completely justified before the Father. This was also made at his baptism. Also at his ascension, as we read earlier, it says that Christ was seen by angels. A quote from Charles Spurgeon says, "The Godhead was seen in Christ by angels as they had never seen before. They saw the justice, they saw the wisdom, they saw the sovereignty, but they had never saw the love and condescension and tenderness and pity in God as they saw these things in the person and the life of Christ." Now, there's so much in this text of 1 Timothy 3:16. It says that he preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world. This same Jesus, that's our mission today, is to preach Christ to the world, to those that we come in contact with, to preach to those around us to believe and trust in Christ. It says in this verse that he was received up in glory. And this reminds us of his ascension from the Mount of Transfiguration. It reminds us of the work that he's doing in on our behalf, the intercession that he is doing for us today in heaven. His body still retains those marks from his crucifixion, the nail prints in his hands, his side, where they shoved the spear into his side. Paul's description, 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18, is another verse. It says, Paul's description of Jesus' character reminds us of the key to our own character of transformation. By beholding Jesus, Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 3:18, "But we all with unveiled faces, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord." Christ is the perfect fulfillment of these descriptions of Christian character. Jesus will transform our character. It's only as we behold Him, as Pilate said, "Behold Him." As we behold Him, our characters will be changed. It is our relationship with Jesus that does it, by beholding Christ. Our relationship will change. In John chapter 1, it says that the Word was made flesh. He's the head of the human race. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 through 17. Hebrews 2, 14 through 17, it says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil." Jesus truly fulfilled the role of elder. He had to take on flesh and blood of humanity. Verse 15, it says, "And deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." Christ, by embracing death on the cross, he destroyed Satan's hold on death and freed all who fear death. We as Christians should have no fear of death. 16, "For verily he took not on himself the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore, in all things, it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people." Now, if Christ was not like us, he could not have become our high priest. He could not represent us before the Father and make atonement for our sins. He took upon him humanity. John chapter 1, verse 41, it tells us that Christ is the Messiah. It tells us here in chapter 1, verse 41 of John that Andrew was going forth to find Simon Peter, his brother. It says he first findeth his own brother Simon, and saith unto him, "We have found the Messiah," which is being interpreted, the Christ. So who is this man? The man that Pilate said to behold. He's the only begotten Son of God, as we read in John 3:16. He's Emmanuel, God with us. He is God manifested in the flesh. He's the head of the human race. He's the Messiah of Bible prophecy. This is who the man is that we are to behold. Turn to Philippians 2, verses 6 through 11. What has he done for you and me? Verses 6 through 11 of Philippians 2. It says, "Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You know, Christ emptied himself of everything when he came to this earth as a baby. He gave up his divine entitlement to his role in heaven. He gave up his divine right, his divine privilege. He forego the heavenly glory that was appointed him. He gave up, and he became a servant of servants here upon this earth. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. It says here that he became poor to make us rich. 2 Corinthians 8, 9, it says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich." He gave up everything to save you and me. I like the way the Message Bible puts it. It says, "You are familiar with the generosity of our Master, Jesus Christ. Rich as he was, he gave it all away for us. In one stroke, he became poor, and we became rich. In him dwelleth not only divinity, but he is the example of perfect humanity." So what does he mean to us? Again, this man, Pilate, said for us to behold. He's the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world. He takes away my sins. He takes away your sins. John chapter 1, verse 29. And this is where John sees Christ coming to him. And he says, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21, it tells us that God made him sin who knew no sin. 2 Corinthians 5, 21, it says, "For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Christ took our sin upon him, and he gave us righteousness in exchange. What a gift he had for us. 1 Timothy 2, verse 5, he's our advocate. He's our mediator before God the Father. 1 Timothy 2:5, it says, "For there is one God, one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus." Have you ever thought of what it was, what Christ's qualification is to be our mediator? It's a combination of the two natures. He is able to act as our mediator. He's equal with God. He is God. He's the mighty God. He's acquainted with the mind of God. By Christ taking on humanity, he has sympathy with our nature. He's our brother, as we've already read. He has sympathy with our infirmities. He knows what it's like to be tempted and tried. He has an interest in our cause. What an awesome God we serve that wants to serve us. Think about the wisdom of God in providing such a mediator. And think of the love that Christ has for each one of us, for him to occupy such a position. Behold the man of destiny. He embodies the manhood of God, that God designed each of us to be. Hebrews 1 verse 3. He's a reflection of God. Remember, Christ said that if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Verse 3 of chapter 1 of Hebrews, it says, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sit down on the right hand of the majesty on high. After he had finished the sacrifice for sins, Christ took his honored place alongside God. Colossians chapter 2 tells us that in him dwell all fullness of the Godhead bodily. Romans 8 verse 29. Romans 8 verse 29. It says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. We are to resemble his Son. We're to be like him. Every true child of God is predestined to conform, to be conformed to the image of Christ. However, we have the freedom of choice. Our precipitation in this eternal plan is essential if we are to be conformed to the image of Christ. As the Son of Man, Christ carried humanity to the highest heaven. He linked man to God, and he linked God to man. Forever and ever, we will be linked. John 20, verse 17, the King of Kings and Lord of Hosts calls himself our brother. It tells us in 20, verse 17, to go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend unto my Father, and to my God, and to your God. Hebrews 2, 16 and 17, we read these just a few moments ago. It says, for verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore, in all things it behooved him to be made like to his brethren. John 6, verse 53 through 57, we see that Christ holds the key to the destiny and the destination of every person born into this world. In verse 53 of John 6, it said, then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Verse 54, whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh, drinketh my blood, dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. The eating of his flesh, the drinking of his blood, means believing in Christ. Meditating upon the cross of Christ gives life to our repentance, gives life to our love, our gratitude to him for what Christ has done upon that cross. You wouldn't think of going all day without food, Why would you want to go all day without meditating upon Christ and looking at Him every day? We live by Him as our bodies live by the food that we intake into us. Turn to Acts 4, verse 12. A couple of more verses that we will look at. Acts 4, verse 12, it says, He is our only way of salvation. It says in verse 12, Neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and His sacrifice upon the cross that we can have salvation. Hebrews 12, 1 through 6. Hebrews 12, 1 through 6. It says, beginning in verse 1, Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. We are to lay aside every weight, sin. We are to lay it aside. And we can do that through the power of the Holy Spirit. It says also that we are to run the race with endurance. And it's going to involve effort and commitment. Verse 2, looking into Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down on the right hand of the throne of God. Pilate said, Behold the man. Behold the man. Think about Christ, what He endured upon that cross for each one of us. The scourging that He endured. The taunts, the ridicules that He went through from the Roman soldiers. Think about that. Verse 3, For consider Him that endured such contradiction of sinners against Himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. Christ is our example here in this. Ye have not yet resisted into blood, striving against sin. Christ yielded His blood for us. We read about what Christ endured for each one of us. Now, some of us may have to endure the shedding of blood before Christ comes again on behalf of Christ. We don't know what lays ahead for us. Verse 5, And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastenings of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of Him. For whom the Lord loveth, He chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom He receiveth. Chastening is a tool of correction. We should receive it gratefully when it comes to us, when He chastens us, correcting each one of us. Christ is our pattern. He's our ideal of true humanity. And we should strive for it our Savior. He's our friend. He's our brother. And in Him we can trust. I trust that we humbly and truly love Him this morning. I trust that we adore Him for the gift that He has given us. I trust that He is our hope, our only hope this morning. What does Christ mean to you personally? Do you need to get to know Christ again? Maybe the question should be, do you need to get to know Christ? Behold the man, Christ Jesus. He's a man of great dignity. He's a man of complete self-control. He's a meek man. He's a man chosen of God to bring mankind back. He's a man of destiny, because all in heaven and earth, past, present, future, centers in Him. It was made by Him, for Him. What is your concept of this man that Pilate said to behold? It's our relationship with Christ that builds our character. It's our character that's going to get us into heaven. By beholding, we become changed. Our character is changed when we behold Christ. As Pilate said, behold the man, Christ Jesus. Our closing hymn, hymn 186. I found a friend, oh, such a friend.